1980s, when Greg Bolt was approached by someone in his church about writing a song, he could not have known how it would ultimately change his life. The person's request was to pen a song for Pastor Appreciation Day. Many years later, Bolt would recount to Contemporary Christian Music magazine what happened next. He said, "I said I would try, and I thought I had plenty of time. 8 weeks. Well, the time flew by, and I was just not having any success. Finally, a night before Pastor Appreciation Day, I was sitting at my piano, trying to write something. And as I sat there, I began to think about the people who have had the greatest impact on my life, and realized that none of them were famous. They were people like Sunday school teachers, youth leaders, neighbors, and in that list, I included my pastor, Eldon Morehouse. I decided to write a song that honored all of them, and I performed Thank You the next morning in church. If you aren't familiar with Greg Bolt, know that this song, Thank You, became for him a debut hit. It helped to launch him to stardom in contemporary Christian music for over 15 years. But 20 years after the song's initial release, many of Ray's colleagues and fans abandoned him, all because he publicly came out. Nevertheless, the impact of his many successful songs had already been made, and it continues on even today, as he continues to perform his older hits while including new material as well. He even performed at MCCLV High Valley in September of 2013, when North 4th Street in Allentown was where this congregation called. I share this not just because I'm a huge fan, even though I am, but because the text of his song, Thank You, was part of this two-part sermon series, leading us along with our sacred scripture on a powerful journey on what it is to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. Evangelism is the churchy word, right? Yeah. Please don't be. This is the churchy word we use for this. And many in the church today, particularly in the West, are, let's say, not quick to do it. For some, what evangelism is it really clear? For those who are more certain, shying away from evangelism is often a matter of fear or a sense that such an act is inappropriate in today's culture. But this is our Great Commission. Captured at the end of Matthew's Gospel, it is still in effect today. You can say it with me, you probably know it. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations. So what then? What does that song, Thank You, have to do with any of it? Well, first, let's set some definitions. Then we'll turn to the song. Are you ready? Okay. Woo-hoo. Evangelism, a noun form of the verb evangelize. Evangelize, from the Greek verb euangelizo, which means to announce good news. Now, you slightly alter euangelizo, and you get euangelion, which is more specifically whatever the good news is that's being proclaimed. And this word, euangelion, is important to us because it is typically translated into English as gospel. Yes, gospel, as in the gospel according to Mark. Mark 1 begins, the beginning of the euangelion, the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Notice that nowhere in those definitions did we find to convert, badger, implement scare tactics, ring doorbells, or shout the street with a bullhorn. Let's breathe together a sigh of relief. Now for the song.
was it?
We'll focus this week on just verse 1. Verse 2 is for next week. The lyrics of verse 1 go like this. I dreamed I went to heaven. You were there with me. We walked upon the streets of gold beside the crystal sea. We heard the angels singing. Then someone called her name. We turned and saw the young man, and he was smiling as he came. And he said, friend, you may not know me now. And he said, but wait, you used to teach my Sunday school when I was only 8. Every week, you would say a prayer before the class would start. And one day, when you said that prayer, I asked Jesus in my heart. Once again, the absence of any form of to convert, to badge, or implement scare tactics, ring doorbells, or shout and scream with a bullhorn. In all seriousness, those things are not at the core of what it means to evangelize. Might there ever be a time when any or all of those things may be contextually appropriate? Sure. But if we're ever going to have a meaningful conversation about how the Church of Jesus Christ has been called out and called on to share His good news to the very ends of the earth, we need to momentarily push some of that baggage aside. So then, if evangelism doesn't require us to convert or to badger, to influence scare tactics, ring doorbells, or shout in the street with a bullhorn, then what does it require from us? Remember that viewing the listo is simply to announce good news. So what's the good news? Too vague of a question. It could be anything. But wait. Aren't the biblical books of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John referred to as Gospels? And if gospel translates to the good news that's being announced, then maybe we found it. The good news is whatever those four authors said. So, this sure said a lot, Randy. Can't we simplify this a bit further? I think so. It isn't so much about every last word of the text as it is the everlasting word in the text. Yes, the good news could be a lot of things for a lot of people, but for the entire history of the Christian movement, our good news has been Jesus Christ, the Son of God. In John, Jesus is actually called the Word. So we all do as the gospel writers did. We proclaim the Word. If you ask most Christians what the Word of God means, they'll tell you, I don't know its origins, but this is an idiom. Because the Bible never claims in explicit terms to be the Word from God, although it does pronounce Jesus as such. See, the Bible isn't the thing. Jesus is the thing. The Bible is an arrow. Jesus is the bullseye. What the gospel writers do, as what all Scripture ultimately does, is guide us to a divine relationship. And Jesus, who is God with us, most looks like that to us. You know, John doesn't even hide his motive. Writing near the end of chapter 20, it says, now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples. This is near the end of his life. Which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God. And that through believing you may have life in his name. There you go. Jesus lived an exemplary life. He died an undeserved death. Jesus rose from death to glorified life. We do well to call this a mystery. For I know no one, myself included, who has shared in such an experience. A small number of people may have lived truly exemplary lives. And even a smaller number may have been wrongfully murdered. But who among them, who among even them, has returned to life in a new glorified state. Thus we marvel at this tale of a poor, itinerant Jewish man who boldly proclaimed, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." Even though this ultimately cost him his very life. The story intrigues us. It moves us. It transforms us. This is why Paul wrote to the Christians in Rome, "I am not ashamed of the gospel, of the Evangelion, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who has faith." The core of our message as Christians is Jesus. Stick to that and you can't go wrong. Don't share only the warm and fuzzy Jesus. And don't share only the grumpy Jesus. But do share Jesus. It's because we've been transformed by the good news of Jesus that we understand his instruction to make more disciples. We believe the message can affect change. In the first verse of that song, "Thank You," a Sunday school teacher's continual message about Jesus clearly affected change. Even if that teacher didn't comprehend at the time the change that it could have. In our Old Testament text today, we find that Jonah also knew his message could affect change. Living before the time of Jesus, his message was a little different. But I still believe that he knew that by being obedient to the message God asked him to deliver, that his listeners might respond. We heard in chapter 3 of Jonah's story this morning. But do we remember how it began? Listen to the opening of chapter 1. "Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai, saying, 'Go at once to Nineveh, that great city, and cry out against it, for their wickedness has come up before me.' But Jonah set out to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. He went down to Joppa and found a ship going to Tarshish, so he paid his fare and went on board to go with him to Tarshish, away from the presence of the Lord." We say that Jonah didn't want to go to Nineveh, but that's not what the text says. Jonah set out to flee from the presence of the Lord. Just receiving the message was likened to being in the very presence of God. And Jonah knew who and what kind of God his God was, as we will find out later in the story. God's directed to Jonah reflects a grace and a compassion that reaches far beyond the boundaries of Israel. Nineveh was the capital of the Assyrian Empire, the same empire that would often sack the northern kingdom generations after Israel splits in two. Yet God sends Jonah to Nineveh with a message. After Jonah attempts to give God the long runaround, we all know what happens in chapter 1 and 2. He arrives at Nineveh. He says his bid. And what happens? The people repent. And God spares the city. Everyone is saved. Yay! And who's not happy? Well, according to the final chapter of the book, it's none other than Jonah. And why is he so miserable? Hear it from his own lips. "Oh Lord, is this not what I said while I was still in my own country? That is why I fled to Tarshish at the beginning, for I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love, and ready to relent from punishment." For all the times Christians hesitate to evangelize someone, because another person might say no? How many times do we hesitate because we're afraid they might say yes? Sharing the good news God has gifted you with, you may be an instrument through which someone else's life is forever changed. And this is a very good thing. And it has nothing to do with you. And that is also a very good thing. Consider Jonah's proclamation. 40 days more, and Nineveh will be overthrown. Obviously, the biblical account is abridged. I mean, there had to be more back and forth than that. But whatever else Jonah said, it had to have been blessed by God with an authority that made it sound convincing. I mean, what credibility does Jonah have in this situation? He's a Jew, away from his people's land, in another land where another people worship other gods. There is nothing to give him the slightest leg up or inside line with anyone. In fact, his opening line wasn't even true. Question mark? God said to cry out against the wickedness, but chapter 1 had no mention of impending doom. Where'd that come from? Man, Jonah, how many ways can you mess this up? But nonetheless, the people of Nineveh believed God. Despite all of Jonah's negatives, God still turned the situation into a win. Now, we see Jesus talking to people in the Gospels. He has much the same reaction on people, albeit without all the baggage of Jonah. More than once, we find people saying aloud about Jesus, "What is this? A new teaching with authority." Sure, our Mark passage today involved an unclean spirit being cast out, kind of a big deal. But other times, it's just Jesus being Jesus. And his words simply ring true in the ears of his hearers. Sometimes, Jesus even lost followers because his teaching proved to be too much. See John chapter 6. When you share the good news, Jesus, you are on spiritual surround sound. The Holy Spirit amplifies the message and testifies to its accuracy. Sure, human factors are still a part of the equation, but God adds something to the mix that you just can't get anywhere else. Just like the Sunday school teacher in that song, you have God's Son sending you on God's authority with God's Spirit to share a simple message. That may change someone's life. Oh, and although this could be a whole other sermon itself, don't fret over the possibility that they don't accept the message. If to evangelize is to merely announce good news, you can only be faithful to your part. It's because I believe so much in the power of the gospel of Jesus that my very first call as an MCC pastor has been to work within MCC's emerging ministries. An emerging ministry is anything that is not a standard, affiliated, standalone congregation. And that includes would-be congregation that don't exist yet. Susquehanna Valley MCC is the emerging ministry that I'm called to shepherd. I invite you to remember us in your prayers. We are actually meeting for a fellowship dinner later this evening to do some planning for our events of the year. We are not yet a large group. We operate in the Susquehanna Valley, north of Harrisburg, where the next closest MCC, which is MCC of the Spirit, is about an hour or more away. There are still people in that region that need to be reached with the message of Jesus, LGBT people or otherwise. Particularly, I believe that the good news of Jesus is conveyed through MCC with, how shall I say, a certain flavor that may not come across in other churches. Our passionate belief in radical inclusion mandates that we understand Jesus' promise of whosoever believeth in truly the broadest terms. There are no limitations. It doesn't matter who you are, who you think you are, who you thought you were, who you have not yet become. What matters right now is, have you heard the good news of Jesus, the Son of God? Have people around SVMCC heard it? My mission is to bring it to them. But this is our collective call to evangelism, to proclaim the word wherever we are. There's also another side to spreading the gospel. There are times when you yourself are not able to be the one doing that work. But that will be our topic for next week. In the meantime, share the Evangelion, the good news of Jesus, in whatever way makes sense for you. It doesn't have to be as a Sunday school teacher. It could be as simple as telling a friend your story with Jesus. Imagine the gospel according to you.